Happy Valentine's Day, and welcome to Day 2 of the Hearthstone Championship Tour Europe Winter Preliminary. I am Robert Worthenwing, joined on the desk by Soddle of Complexity Gaming, and Savige from Team Liquid. Guys, we witnessed some pretty crazy upsets yesterday. I don't think anyone would have expected the results we saw from Day 1 of this event. Soddle, anything really stick out for you?
Yeah, it was a crazy day. Very unexpected day, not only in some of the results that we saw with the top players that you may know and love being knocked down, at least into loser's bracket, if not out of the tournament entirely, but also kind of an interesting tournament in terms of the kind of contained tournament meta. I was taking a look at the stats page last night, which you at home can get to if you just type exclamation mark bracket in chat. It'll take you to the Battlefy page, which you can then get to the stats from. One of the things that stood out to me was the top three win rate classes. I believe were Mage and Paladin, which reasonably expected. But then third place was Hunter, which is kind of strange because Hunter's somewhat considered a weak class at the moment. But that win rate for Hunter primarily came from being 90% against Warlocks.
Yeah, that's always been an area where they've really shined, really going back from the beginning of Hearthstone when Hunter was first popularized. So great insight into that. And Savis, did you see anything that really kind of stood out to you?
Well, the amount of aggressive Warlocks was definitely a surprise to me. I did expect a lot of players to be bringing Warlock, but the amount of so-called zoo Warlocks or aggressive Warlocks was very surprising. And a lot of players seem to be doing well with it, too.
Yeah, we saw a lot of fresh faces yesterday, a lot of names that maybe some of you at home hadn't heard of. I know you had mentioned both that you'd played some of them before in Community Cups as well as on Ladder, but that's kind of the great thing about the Hearthstone Championship Tour is, you know, these preliminaries that lead into seasonal championships really give players the opportunity to come in and show what they can do and really shine on a big stage for them. And, you know, we saw them just taking out some of the established pro players left and right. And Hearthstone Championship Tour, as I mentioned yesterday, is basically the stuff leading up to the Hearthstone World Championship later this year. It's things like ranked play season, the community cups, all the majors that lead into the seasonal preliminaries and the seasonal championships. And it's not just about winning the big prize and the big title at the Hearthstone World Championship anymore. You can win prizes at these seasonal championships where you can win part of a prize pool of $100,000, as well as if you're the first place person, you actually just win your spot to BlizzCon.
Yeah, it's a hugely exciting thing for a competitive player to have this kind of Blizzard-sanctioned tour going the whole way through the year. Lots of opportunities just to pick up major titles that carry prestige and prize money for in their own right, but also numerous opportunities to qualify for the Hearthstone World Championship itself.
Yeah, the first four matches that we have today, all of the winners from those matches will be the first four guys to qualify to the Winter Championship next month.
Right, so as you mentioned, these first four matches, these players have actually already breached top 16. They've already earned $2,500. For them, it's just basically an opportunity to earn more money and their trip to the Europe Winter Championship taking place on March 18th through March 20th. So a lot on the line for these players. And it's not just necessarily about like keeping the momentum going and just trying to win the next match, but it's really about trying to make a name for themselves, earn some of that prestige you were talking about, Soddle, and really carve out their own reputation and their own story in the 2016 Hearthstone Championship Tour season.
Yeah, that's going to be the big test for them now, is that these games have now got extremely important. The level of stakes has risen exponentially. And we've seen, you know, the one thing that can be said about all these players, especially the ones that you haven't heard of, is that they are quality players. They've got here on merit. They've qualified through a very, very tough competitive format to even be here. But maybe they'll be a little bit more susceptible to nerves than the professional players, which means that now they're really being tested as the stakes have gone up, that they really have to play their optimal Hearthstone.
Yeah, for all of these eight guys in the winner's bracket right now, these first matches are going to be the most important ones that they've ever played in Hearthstone.
Yeah, we kind of saw that just a little bit yesterday with some of the players actually, you know, getting up on camera for the first time, playing against some of these pro players. And some of them seemed a little bit rattled at times, but for the most part, you know, there wasn't a lot of pressure. And they were actually just down to make these really great lines of play. They understood what they had to do to win and who they were playing against. And I think even with the actually coming up as one of these players who's not known, there are advantages, right? People don't necessarily know your strategies, know your play style, so it's not necessarily something where you're necessarily having to compensate for what your reputation suggests, like we maybe saw with Gaara, who's a player who, you know, we know brings kind of these unusual decks and these unusual techs. You kind of suspect that when you play against him.
Yeah, that's very true. And, you know, people talk about how Gaara sometimes gets a little advantage because of these twists that he has in his deck. As an unknown player, you kind of have that advantage by default because people have no idea what to expect from you. They're not just expecting possibly one or two twists. You could be bringing something entirely new. And I know from some of the unknown players that we've spoken to recently, one or two of them have said that they have a bit of a penchant for playing some fun and interesting decks. We might be able to see some cool stuff today.
Right. And now we're going to go to the man who refuses to be my Valentine over in the host area, Frodan.
Never asked me, But maybe you can ask me off screen after this upcoming match that we have coming up. Welcome, everybody, to the Winter Prelims Day Number 2 from the ESL Studios. My name is Frodan. I am pleasured to bring you guys this awesome side of the event tavern that we're going to be doing a lot of cool interviews throughout the entire day. Let's go ahead and talk about the 8 players that are remaining so far in the winner's bracket. They just have to win one more match before they are guaranteed a spot in the Winter Championships in March. For our first match today, we have Dr. Hippie versus Tars, and we have 3 other matches going on. We have Pokrovok versus Lockery, Nick Slay versus Bunny Hopper, and Diggin versus Colomwan. Now, I'm pretty sure I butchered all of those names in my American English. However, we're going to get to know those players a little bit more as we get to see the winners and ultimately the interviews as the day progresses. In the meantime, guys, we're going to hop on over to a fireside gathering with Michael from Sweden, who is waiting to talk about what's going to be happening today. Michael, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. Hello.
Hello, how are you doing? How has the fireside been so far for you? And what's the atmosphere like over there in Sweden?
It's awesome. I'm right here at the Inferno Online Odenplan in Stockholm. And at the player area, so we have all the professional players sitting around me. So it's pretty cool.
That's awesome.
We have a meet and greet area as well when fans show up so they can take photos and talk to the favorite players. So it's been super cool.
Yeah, it sounds really fun being able to meet all the players and just get people all excited in one little area. Can you talk to me about who's remaining in the competition on in your venue specifically? Can you remember anybody that's made it through so far?
Yeah, we actually have 3 players left out of 13, so it's been kind of a slaughter here. Uskaka was knocked out, unfortunately, and a few others. And we have 3 players left, and that is Illuminare. And we also have Shov remaining, and Paten.
Oh, that's right. Shov's going to be playing up against Gaara in the lower bracket. What a brutal matchup. But, I mean, in this case, you just win or go home for some of these guys. Can you talk to me about some of the favorite things about your event so far from your perspective, whether the player's there or, you know, personally for you?
Well, I've seen that it's been a huge interest for the events. We actually have 2 venues. So we have one here at Inferno Line, which is Esports Arena. And we have one at a bar in Old Town in Stockholm for those more interested in beer and watching Hearthstone.
That's a very fitting theme, I guess, for the entire tavern setting. That's awesome. Well, thanks so much for being able to organize everything. I know a lot of people don't appreciate or they don't really know too much about what's going on in the community, but because of thanks to you guys, we're able to have all these people travel locally instead of, you know, flying all to one destination. Do you have anything you want to say, address to the community or to anybody that you want to mention as a shout out?
I want to thank my organization, Stockholm Esport, and I also want to thank all of the Hearthstone community and players. Everyone is so friendly and awesome. So go to your local fireside.
Couldn't agree more. Thank you so much, Michael, and hope to see you on the other side very soon as we're getting ready for our first match of the day. It is going to be, once again, Dr. Hippie versus Tars, 2 players that you're not necessarily familiar with, but you should start getting to know. Now, the way that the matches are going to be going down is the same as yesterday. We're going to be doing a Conquest Best of 5. But this time around, if you haven't been able to pay attention yesterday because, say, the matches weren't around a good time for you, don't worry. We haven't changed Conquest too much from last year. We still have pretty much the same thing. You have to win with one game per deck. However, we do have the ability to ban a deck before the match starts. You have to choose it prior to the game starting. You can't change halfway through. It's not like, I wanted to ban the Warlock, but now I want to switch to the Mage. Once you make your selections, you are locked in. However, before each game, it's a blind pick format. Just make sure that you win one game with each class, and you're good to go. Also, we want to encourage you guys to stay engaged in the conversation. Let us know what you guys are thoughts on the match throughout the day by tweeting at @PlayHearthstone, or you can go to facebook.com/Hearthstone. Let us know some of your favorite moments of the matches. So we're going to hand over back to Rob, Asadol, and Saviz and let them get you ready for the first match of the day. I'm going to be excited to see what's going to be happening because pretty soon we're going to have our first European finalists for the Winter Prelims. Rob, back over to you.
Thank you, Dan. As you pointed out, bans have been a big part of the story thus far at the Winter European Preliminaries. And guys, Going forward, are you expecting any changes in maybe ban philosophy? Do you think these players have maybe had a chance to research each other, kind of figure out what each other is playing? Or do you kind of expect it to be more, which you pointed out, Zottl, which is kind of a thing of you just want to ban out the thing that could potentially give your lineup fits?
Yeah, ban strategy in Conquest is very, very interesting. Just having ban in the format in the first place opens up more options like Freeze Mage, which we have seen a lot of, just because you can straight away just ban out a polarizing matchup like mid-range Druid or any warrior, basically. Also, any Finn Paladin goes along the same kind of lines where the matchups are very polarized. So just having a ban in your format opens up that sort of thing.
Yeah, personally, I'm a huge fan of the ban inclusion for this year. I think that's a whole new layer of strategy for all of these players. Like the thing that you mentioned with Freeze Mage, suddenly it becomes more available. And you can pair it up with maybe a Rogue, which is also like, has a lot of the same good and bad matchups. So you can kind of eliminate the Warrior or Druid and have good two decks with almost no counters.
Right, so this first match, as Dan pointed out, is going to be Tarz versus Dr. Hippie. Sorry, not a mister. He's a doctor. He went to school.
Oh, he's got his doctorate in hippie.
I was going to say, you've been doing a lot of research on these players, Zottl. So
I have, yeah.
What can you tell us about these two players?
Yeah, Dr. Hippie, the thing that stood out for me, and I hope I've got this right because I was translating it with a bit of Google Translate and some very, very broken French, but it sounds like in the January season, he was the first player to hit Legend, and that's impressive on its own. But most people trying to race to Legend usually play, you know, Aggro Shaman, Midrange Druid, Fast decks. This guy was playing Freeze Mage.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's, well, you know, there was an interesting conversation I once had with Ben Brode, and he was saying that, you know, if you're really good at a control deck and you're just winning all your matches, I mean, you are ultimately going to get there quickly if you're just winning a high percentage of these matches, and no doubt we have an accomplished Freeze Mage player on our hands.
Right.
Yeah, Freeze Mage is a great pick against a lot of these Paladins that has been a common theme. It's one of the most popular decks. Does struggle a little bit against Druids, which is also popular, but with the ban, you can always ban it out if you want to.
Right, and speaking of bans, we see that Dr. Hippie has his Warlock deck banned out by Tarz, and Tarz has his Paladin deck banned out by Dr. Hippie, and these are two bans that don't really seem all that surprising to me, especially if Tarz hasn't had a chance to see exactly what Dr. Hippie's Warlock deck is. Warlock has that wide range, so it's not necessarily easy to figure out your mulligans against them or even predict what kind of deck you're going to run into, so you just say, I don't want to deal with it. I'm just going to take it off the table. And, you know, of course, Paladin, one of those decks which has been very successful thus far in this tournament, has that extremely powerful curve in the early going, has great late game options, especially with the Ragnaros starting to be teched in. So these bans don't necessarily seem all that surprising to me.
Yeah, Paladin has the second highest win rate in the tournament so far from what we saw yesterday. But what is interesting to me is we do see Dr. Hippie as carrying Mage in his lineup. So I would suspect, based on that information, that it is a Freeze Mage. And yet he's still chosen to ban the Paladin, which is a very favorable matchup for his Freeze Mage. Of course, it's one of the quirks of Conquest that you can't rely on getting the one matchup that you want. That deck might win and then you never get your Freeze Mage to match up against it. So it might be that he's just scared of Paladin overall. A lot of players have been. Paladin's been the third most banned class overall as of yesterday. So like you said, a lot of people are just choosing to ban out the solid, consistent, scary decks. Just get rid of them.
Yeah, but I'm also really surprised by that Paladin pick. With that lineup, I would not have expected him to ban that out. But could the mage be something different? Maybe he has the capability to play multiple different type of mages and chose to bring maybe a tempo mage to this tournament.
It's very possible, but even a tempo mage, reasonably good matchup against Secret Paladin anyway, because of the Flame Waker, Arcane Missiles, Arcane Blast, etc., all the tempo that you can generate. So definitely a really interesting line with the ban choice there, I think.
Right, and it's important to note that yesterday we actually saw Freeze Mage versus Secret Paladin, and at least when we were casting it, you know, that was something where we actually saw the Freeze Mage lose to the Paladin because the Paladin just kept putting things on the board. The Freeze Mage never got to the board clears. The Doomsayer got silenced because of the inclusion of the Ironbeak Owl, which is a huge swing in that matchup, actually. And we're going to go ahead and hop right into game one here, and it's going to be the old Druid Mirror match.
Oh, baby.
Yeah, this is one of those matches that swings, and when it swings very quickly.
Right.
Some of the early keys here, you want to start finding that early game ramp, those innervates, those wild growths. We see Shade of Noxramas and Dr. Hippie's hand, and that is a really powerful card against Druid because it's not necessarily something that Druid can deal with until the person with the Shade of Noxramas is ready to expose it.
Yep. Yeah. Sorry, go ahead.
Sometimes in this matchup, when one of the players picks up those mana cards and the other one doesn't, it might look a little bit one-sided, but let's see if one of those players can pick up a remarkably better hand than the other one.
Yeah, we have seen Tarz whiff on that early game ramp, but Dr. Hippie's still taking his time to make the decision here. He's looking at a very, very strong hand if he fills one of his mulligan slots with a ramp card. The problem is, if he keeps multiple cards here because the curve is strong, he's minimizing his chances of hitting the ramp. He may even be considering holding on to that Wrath, so he may or may not have information about whether Tarz is including Darnassus Aspirant in his deck.
right? Wow. We saw Big Game Hunter in Tarz's opening hand, and this is one of those cards you normally do not want to get stuck with in the hand early on because it's not a great tempo play. Obviously, it's very frail, but when you're playing against Druid and the chance for Innervate Dr. Boom is there, it's not necessarily a bad keep. Savige, you look like your face just lit up. What's on your mind?
I was looking at Dr. Hippie's hand, and I would have kept only the Shade, but instead he chose to keep the Broth and two Shredders.
Yeah, so
extremely surprised by that decision.
I agree with you. That was the mulligan that I was looking at too. But I guess in his mind, maybe his turn two would be Wrath of Darnassus Aspirant, and then he has Coin Shredder, Shredder. Yeah. That's a possible line. But that is very, very dependent on reacting to exactly what your opponent is going to do. I agree with you. I just like Coin Shade turn two, and we go from there.
I'm going to be really interested to see how this works out for him. I mean, coining into Shredder, playing another Shredder on turn four, that's not a bad curve at all. But keeping that many cards, in case that there's nothing to rot, you might kind of struggle.
Tarz goes right into that convenient turn three Shade of Naxxramas, and that's just going to sit there until Tarz feels either pressured enough to reveal it or until he goes to finish off the game with something like a Savador Force of Nature.
Yeah, something that people have got a lot better at recently is recognizing the opportunity that they may get a free attack in with a Shade and get it to attack twice. Generally, if you develop another strong minion on board, especially if it's something like Druid of the Claw that can protect it with Taunt, you can take a value trade with the Shade, and you have this consolidated board presence anyway, and your opponent as the Druid isn't good at dealing with minions, so they're unlikely to deal with two at once. So I wouldn't be surprised if that Shade came out maybe a little bit earlier than you might be expecting it to.
I think he might also hold on to it as long as he can. Personally, I'm a huge fan of getting the Shade out early in this matchup because there's simply no way to really deal with it.
Right.
Druid AoE only deals one damage on collateral, so it's not no effects like Consecration or Holy Nova to take it out. So once it's there, it's gonna be there until the player who played it decides to unstall it.
Look at the tension on this board. We see two Shredders on one side and a Shade and another Shredder on the other side. And going forward, both of these players have great curves going into 5, 6, and 7. So this is going to really pick up quickly here. And I think, you know, and this is kind of the infamous legacy of Piloted Shredder thus far, but it's going to be on the Shredders to kind of figure out, like, how this game progresses in the next few turns. If we see stuff, you know, like 2-3s or just nice 3-2s that come out, it might not make all that big a difference. But something like one show, Patient Assassin. There it is.
No swipe in the hand of Dr. Hippie, which is one of the most devastating answers to a Patient Assassin. So that thing is going to be free to get some value here.
Yep. I wouldn't be surprised to see the load up here just to protect that Assassin. Because from Arceus' point of view, his opponent could have the swipe right now. So playing the Drake would just give away such an excellent swipe.
Yeah, we see the Garrison Commander drop off of Dr. Hippie Shredder. And Garrison Commander for Druid, really not a big deal. You can pump up your hero power to 2, which is certainly nice. You get a little bit of extra armor, but it's not as crazy as it could be, say, like a double life tap or something like that, or a double fire blast even. So. And you talked about that value trade coming out, Zoddle, and there it is. He just feels confident now. He's got the 5 on the board. He's got Patient Assassin.
Yep.
And Swipe cannot take out the Patient Assassin, so this is a great board for Tarz.
Yeah, this is exactly the moment I talked about earlier where it's, you know, I could leave my Shade there in stealth.
That Patient Assassin is absolutely huge right now because Dr. Hippie wanted to play that low tip, but I don't think he can right now. Just has to go with the Keeper to take out the Shade or something.
Yeah, absolutely. Shade is going to be dealt with, but you know, even though it feels bad, he's lost his Shade that he could have left in stealth to grow. It's still, you know, he still has that Lower Third consolidated on board, so he still has the board advantage. He still has the Patient Assassin to make a solid trade.
Right. We've seen the way players utilize Lothab has been pretty huge thus far in this tournament. We've seen where, you know, against freeze mages, it's one of those things where you want to generally save it for certain turns to block something like an ice block or a combination of spells. And in this situation, I think that was a really good use of Lothab. Obviously, you can use it to block out the combo later on, but I really like what happened there. He couldn't use the Living Roots to finish off the Lothab with the Shredder trade, so I think that was a really good use of it. What do you guys think?
Oh yeah, absolutely. In this matchup, you quite often just want to play it early on, because if you wait for later turns, then your opponent might be able to play something like a Dr. Boom or Ancient of Lore, and in that case, you get zero value out of the Lothab.
And I love Tarz not being too greedy with that Patient Assassin here. We can see from our perspective that he's free to wait as long as he likes to pick up whatever trade he wants with that Assassin because there's no swipe in hand. But from Tarz's perspective, he played the Lower Third last turn. So in his mind, I blocked that swipe. He couldn't have swiped that turn. That this turn, he could have swiped. Patient Assassin would have gone, so he just picked up the clean Shredder trade.
Yep, it didn't end up being that meaningful as with the effect, because it only took down a Tree Toughness minion, which 3-2 could have done too. But it was more than that, because it also did stop the Lothab from getting played.
Yeah, absolutely have to respect that patient assassin on the board. And I agree. I like this idea of taking kind of the middle road play as opposed to rolling high to hope to get to like something like, I don't know, an Ancient of War or an Emperor Thorsen. So he does get value out of it, and he, you know, is firmly in control of the board right now. Unfortunately, has to play down Lothep into this board here, and that, I don't think that's necessarily what he wanted to do, but it's not as bad as it could be. Like, I think he's in a better position than he necessarily could be.
It's not the worst thing in the world, because he is asking for a source of one damage from a Druid on turn 7. And turn 7 is a turn where Druid just wants to spend 7 mana on a single card, be it Dr. Boom, be it Ancient of Lore. So the fact that that Lothep kind of wants to be hero-powered is a little bit awkward. And if he chooses not to hero-power, the Lothep now just has a nice trade against the 5-5 Ancient of Lore.
He does get some good cards, though, off that Ancient of Lore. Second Force of Nature there. So he's got two Forces of Nature. He's got a Savage Roar. Might even see something like a Force of Nature before the game is over, used to clear off a big minion off the board.
Yeah, Tharz is pulling quite far ahead on the card counts right now. He also has the second Ancient of Lore and a combo waiting already, so Tharz definitely ahead right now. But maybe if Dr. Hippie picks up the second combo piece, he might be able to end the game before Tharz has the time to do his.
Yeah, Dr. Hippie is in a bit of an awkward spot here. Emperor, his only proactive play, but although he does have the Force of Nature in hand, the rest of the cards aren't really the stuff that you want to be hitting. Getting zero mana Living Roots is okay. Wrath is reasonable for one, but that Innovate draw is pretty scary for Tharz right now. Still a little bit off lethal with the Innovate combo right now, but it's going to allow him to do a ton of damage in the future.
Absolutely. Definitely helps with so many cards in the hand that Innervate allows him to get some extra cards played. Here on this turn, probably looking at either a Swipe or a Force of Nature wouldn't be that bad either since he has two.
Yeah, Swipe definitely seems to line up pretty well against this board, but as you said, Force of Nature, kind of a more awkward card to use, so in a situation where it seems fine here, it might be reasonable to use it, but Tharz looks like he's going for a different line entirely. Going to start with the Keeper, maybe Keeper Swipe, so he won't have to use the hero power, develops an extra minion for the combo on board. This seems totally reasonable to me.
Yeah, he has a good grip on the board and the combo waiting. Everything is going Tharz's way right now.
Obviously, he could have used his hero power to deal that last 1 point of damage, but he's down to 22 health, which you say down to 22 health, which seems ridiculous, but when you're playing against a druid, anytime you're below about 25, it starts occurring to you, I could just be dead.
Yeah, not just playing against a druid, but playing against a druid who already had his emperor down with 5 cards in hand, so there could be a double combo waiting.
I think it's extremely interesting. You were just talking about being scared of your life total as a druid. He chose to innovate hero power there at 22, and what that is based on is his opponent has just played emperor. So something like double combo is possible, and that Innovate hero power actually plays around it.
Yeah, there's no double combo, but there's actually quite a bit of damage still. With the Living Roots and one combo, that would be 16 direct damage.
And this is one of those things where we point out that these players who've gotten this far absolutely deserve to be here, and it's not one of those things where Tharz doesn't know how much damage that double combo will do. He totally gets it. He understands where he is, and that Innervate hero power is absolutely reflecting that he knows exactly how high his health needs to be to survive certain things.
Right, and it's not so much just the knowledge of knowing how much damage it is. It's being in that moment and identifying how can I lose. Like, I'm in such a good spot. How can I lose this game? That's the one way.
Yeah, and also looking at this hand, it kind of seems like he might not need the Innervate for later on, so it seems completely fine to just use it there.
For Dr. Hippie now, he's at a point where he just has to keep clearing the board. He has to keep clearing the board, make sure things die. He obviously understands that that combo does 14 damage. He's at 19 health right now, and any other minions on the board just bolsters the amount of damage that Tharz can do. Tharz is in a great spot, though. He's got that Ancient of Lore sitting in hand. He can play down more minions. He's got combo. He's got Big Game Hunter in case Dr. Boom makes an appearance. So Tharz is sitting...
Wow.
Well, now, obviously, Big Game Hunter does, in fact, take out Dr. Boom, but those Boom bots can be quite problematic, especially when you're sitting at 20 health.
Does he really need to play the Dr. Boom here? Because it seems like an unnecessary risk compared to the Ancient of Lore.
I
might have been just fine, but...
Yeah, I completely agree with you. I think you saw him consider it as well. He picked up the Dr. Boom and then thought about it. And this just seems to allow for a BGH tempo swing that you didn't have to give the opportunity to your opponent for.
Right. Quite often when you see Dr. Boom in your hand and the borders are glowing green, it's good to play it, but Tharz is in such a commanding lead that I feel like this might give Dr. Hippie an opening here.
So I do want to point out, though, Big Game Hunter comes down, kills your Dr. Boom, one hero power to kill a bomb. You don't necessarily know if your opponent can take out that other bomb. It is an extra target for Savage Roar, so that might be something that was kind of factoring in for him. Four damage!
Wow.
That is a big, mean Boombot.
Yeah, he's playing his minions first, trying to get that Boombot to not hit face.
And this is... Okay, so he is barely alive by one damage. That initial boom bot was extremely scary, but the second one going to a minion means he is just about still in the game. And now we see that tempo swing that we talked about, Savitz. He's slightly ahead on the board. He has a little bit of a board, but Tar's still in a pretty comfortable position if he can address this. Probably just uses a Savage Roar here to clear up, drops a Shade, seems reasonable to me.
Force of Nature,
Force
I guess?
Force of Nature, yes. Sorry. Yes.
Yeah, that's what you were going for.
Yeah.
Seems pretty good. And with that Shade from the top, he will also be able to get his own minion on the board.
Right, and this kind of puts a soft checkmate into position because basically what you need to clear that Shade now is like a double swipe.
Right.
You need a Starfall, which is really not run these days, so a big taunt would help if he could get a Druid of the Claw out, but we see one swipe there, so he might be able to get that second swipe.
Yeah, he'll have the mana to use it after the Wild Growth. Have we seen a swipe from Dr. Hippie? I'm not entirely sure.
We haven't yet.
Okay. Ancient of Lore to heal is... Wow, okay, I mean, that's an out too, I guess.
That is technically going to put him above the threshold from what we can see in Tarz's hand at the moment.
Yep, that does keep him alive for another turn, but healing with the Ancient of Lore, it just it never feels good.
Yeah, it's definitely one of those play to survive, not play to win situations. Obviously, he has no choice in this situation. You know, he's not necessarily staring at lethal on the board, but you know with 95% confidence that you were dead there if you didn't heal. But still, as you said, Savitz does not feel good ever as a druid.
Yeah, Tharus now looking at his options. Force of Nature would be kind of clean way to clear that lore, but it's the last force for Tharus, so he probably wants to keep it for the roar combo.
So one thing to consider now is right now, you see that Ancient of Lore on the board for Dr. Hippie. So if he Force of Nature Savage Roars with that, I believe that's 21 damage, which puts him one under. But if he has something like that second Living Roots,
right.
That second Living Roots is kind of one of these things where you don't always expect to see it.
It'd also be important that Tarz has kept track of the Emperor cards because at 22, as you said, with the combo with the 5-5 on board doing 21, as long as he knows that none of the cards in Dr. Hippie's hand are Emperor discounted, he knows that the hero power can't come down with it.
Right.
So it's an important thing to keep track of in a tournament situation.
Absolutely. And here, Dr. Hippie starting with the draw. Strong play. He has the swipe to help clearing most of that stuff, but he will still have to take the 4 damage to face unless he wants to use the lore to clear off the big game.
Yeah, unfortunately, this is kind of one of those situations where Dr. Hippie has been on the back foot and forced to react now for quite a few turns, and this doesn't really change anything. He's still continuing to try to clear damage here, and we know, obviously, that he's about to take a pretty big Savage Roar, Force of Nature combo.
Yeah, we know, and I'm pretty sure Dr. Hippie knows deep down in his soul as well what's about to happen to him here.
Oh yeah, absolutely, but killing that big game hunter with the Ancient of Lore, there's no way he would win after that play.
So we are going to see that combo come out, and Tarz is going to wrap up game one, take a one-game lead early over Dr. Hippie. I want to say that was back and forth, but really Tarz kind of got out early, and he just continued to be the aggressor and put the pressure on. Dr. Hippie did a good job of kind of keeping afloat for a while and keeping his health total up. As you said, he had to use Ancient of Lore to heal as opposed to draw cards. At the end of the day, though, Tarz was eventually able to just whittle him down, put enough pressure on the board, and, you know, comes out with the win on that one.
Yep. Yeah, The Patient Assassin had a huge impact, but it was a very intelligently played turn to follow that up, dropping the lower third, trading the Shade, having this awkward position, because actually it was a very even opening. Both players missed ramp, and they just kind of had Shade, Shredder, standard Druid curve openings. So that one moment of just intelligent play was able to be the edge in the game, I think.
Yeah, Dr. Hippie could have maybe went a little bit more aggressive to get the ramp, but he wanted to do the double Shredders. And if he got the ramp anyway, maybe an innervate to get out a turn 2 Shredder and a turn 3 Shredder. That might have been something that Tarz could not have stopped.
Right, so Tarz is next going to have to win with either his Warlock or his Mage. The Druid is officially done for the day. We will not be seeing at least for this series. And Dr. Hippie still has all three decks available to him. I have to imagine that Shaman is that aggro variant Shaman, which we've been seeing a lot of all over ladder and in a few tournaments. Don't really think it's going to be anything else. But at this point, Tarz, I don't think we know what mage deck he's been playing just yet. So have to imagine, though, Freeze Mage. We've only seen one other tempo mage, and it's a deck that is performed inconsistently. So I definitely like the Freeze Mage here, and wouldn't be surprised to see Zoo as well.
Yeah, I mean, some players have had decent success with the tempo mage, but personally, I like the Freeze variant more for these type of tournaments.
Do you enjoy playing Freeze Mage? Cause
I do.
I'm on the Brian Kibler plan where we just both despise Freeze Mage in terms of playing it or watching it because it's so painfully slow compared to Tempo Mage. But as you said, very, very effective deck, very powerful deck in a tournament setting, especially where you do have the ability to ban out Druid. And Warrior, and we have seen one control Warrior, so it does happen from time to time.
Right. Freeze Mage, I think, is also just a very polarizing deck, as you know, you're sharing your opinions on it. Some people love that kind of strategy. Some people love stalling and combo decks and that kind of thing. And some people just get extremely frustrated by, as you said, the length of the games, but also the nature of the game and how uninteractive it can be sometimes.
Well, we have our answer there. As Dr. Hippie opens up with that Freeze Mage, we see Novice Engineer.
Mm. Yeah, that's a unique choice. Could he maybe be playing a Reno variant of the Freeze?
It's a possibility for sure, but also some people just value the Novice Engineer for the immediacy of the card draw. So late game situations, I need to draw something right now. You can just slam the Novice, get the top deck.
It's true. Early on, Loot Hoarder usually is better because it can trade better with something like a Knife Juggler. Mm-hmm. But in later game, having that instant draw can help piece together whatever you need.
Yeah, Tarz, on the other hand, did bring that more aggressive zoo, which we've seen so much of. We see Bran in the opening hand, Doomguard, Flame Imp, Knife Juggler. It's not going to be anything other than zoo. No. This is a matchup where Freeze Mage really shines, because zoo is an aggressive deck, don't get me wrong, and it has the potential to do a lot of damage, but for the most part, it's predicated on board state. It battles for board, and Freeze Mage has a great set of tools to deal with this. And, you know, we see Novice Engineer, so Dr. Hippie's deck could be a little bit different than some of the other ones we've seen. We could see something like Code of Cold, which we've not seen thus far, and obviously, Frost Novas and Blizzards tend to come standard.
Yeah, the double scientist opening looking so good for Dr. Hippie. Ice Block, that's not exactly what he wanted. So if he picks up maybe a second Ice Block from the top, then one of the scientists might not get that much value.
So yeah, straight away, Mad Scientist is going to come down, be able to trade down the board with the Flame Imp, and as you say, summon a secret from the deck. Drawing the Ice Block a little bit unfortunate, but still has enough secrets left in his deck to get full value from both of these scientists, and that's the important thing.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure Dr. Hippie is feeling still quite good about that hand. Even one scientist is so good, but he doesn't have just one, he has two.
So one thing I want to ask you two, as players who play an extremely high caliber here, when I play this matchup all the time, I'm always torn on, do you trade with the Mad Scientist as something like Zoo? Do you just get that Mad Scientist off the board, or are you just going straight up face like he's going and just let them do the trading?
I think face is almost always correct. I don't know how Savitz feels, but there's so much benefit for it. Like, one, you're the aggressor anyway. So, you know, you push in, you make him have the answers. You make him have the punish. Yeah. Secondly, there's always the chance that they draw that secret that you get from the Death Rattle on the turn afterwards.
So. Yeah, like you said, giving that mage extra chance to draw that secret, and also in this particular situation, it was quite obvious that Dr. Hippie would be making the trade anyway, so it feels like a free 3 damage to face.
Absolutely.
Right, and Freeze Mage is obviously not necessarily a deck that's battling for board. More often than not, just wants a nice, happy, empty board.
Yeah.
Nothing going on, just give me more time to get those cards.
Careful there, Rob, you're getting close.
No.
Nice, happy, empty board?
I'd stop myself. Okay. I stopped myself before, you know, this happens in casual conversation too. The Rob boss just sneaks out,
okay.
But Savige is on the desk. I wouldn't do this to him again. So. We do see, though, that Tar is going to play down that second Dark Peddler, and he's already gotten an Abusive Sergeant from the first one, and looks like we're not necessarily going to see. He did end up picking up a second Abusive Sergeant, so that could be really powerful against a mage here, or a Freeze Mage like this, where he can just have that sudden burst damage.
Yeah, those are definitely solid pickups from the peddlers. Some of the better cards that you can hope for.
Okay.
Yeah.
He's just going in right now. 6 damage.
Tarz is officially my new favorite player in this matchup. He knows exactly what happens. If Dr. Hippie's health reaches 0, all the Freeze Mage spells in the world won't save him.
And I like it, honestly, because I was just about to make a point that, sure, Abusive Sergeant seems great, but it's predicated on having a minion in play that is able to attack. And Freeze Mage, the clue's in the name, they're going to freeze your board over and over again, and then they're going to clear it. So why not just jam in those two Abusive Sergeants to face right now? Seems perfectly reasonable.
Yeah, I like it as well. The other option would have probably been the Nerubian Egg if you were expecting an Explosive Sheep from your opponent. But Explosive Sheep is a card that hasn't seen much play lately.
Yeah, I'm not sure why that is, actually. It seems like it might do reasonably well in the meta. Still plenty of Secret Paladin around, and it could be moderately effective against Face Shaman as well, I suppose. So, yeah, I agree with you. I haven't seen much of it, but not entirely sure why.
When League of Explorers first came out, we saw a lot of that in Reno Mage, right? The Explosive Sheep was something you could supplement your deck with to get a little bit more board clear and consistency, even as you were trying to run the one copy of each card. So, otherwise, yeah, I agree. I think Explosive Sheep is actually one of those more underrated cards. Although the 4 mana price tag to actually activate it when you want to can be a little bit unwieldy at times. And Tarz, meanwhile, continuing his agenda of just doing damage. He's not necessarily saving up for anything big. And a lot of times, Zoo can have these clever plays with Knife Juggler and Implosion. But no, it's just Knife Juggler, Wolf, Abusive Sergeant to the face. And at the moment, you know, he's continuing to push that damage. And Dr. Hippie is really still feeling pretty safe.
Another Abusive Sergeant. There is a fourth one somewhere in there, I guess, because the first two were from Dark Peddlers.
We might actually break a record in this game in terms of minions being yelled at.
So it looks like Abusive Sergeant Argus is a very possible play this turn. It plays nicely around Blizzard by buffing up two very valuable minions on board, the Knife Juggler and the Direwolf, above two health. Yeah, ordering doesn't matter here. That Knife Juggler is going to attack for six no matter which order you do it in. So I think we just saw Tars pause for a moment and work that out and then just went ahead and played the Argus.
Yes.
Two Doomsayers in Dr. Hippie's hands, but without the Frost Nova to accompany it, Tars absolutely can deal with it. It's not necessarily a super sexy play. Possibly playing both Doomsayers now might change things a little bit, but I still think he's capable of dealing with it, especially with the Doom Guard. So. And I want to point out on last turn now, there was an option for Tars to tap and then play down the Nerubian Egg, which would have also played around Blizzard because then you would have had the Nerubian. But at this point, tapping with a Doomguard in hand doesn't feel super good.
Yeah, exactly. Tapping with a Doomguard always feels kind of bad. But the Dr. Hippie's hand right now, double Doomsayers. Doomsayer being the abusive. I mean, that would be kind of an interesting play, but
so
he might be desperate enough to draw.
So what would that be? 14 health of Doomsayers against 10 damage on board? I mean, it seems possible. Yeah, I mean, the Knife Juggler is there, which could help. That's definitely a line that might work out for him, but as you said, his hand has just started to look a bit awkward, and I'm not sure what happened, because we spent the first two or three turns just saying, wow, and whoa, let me stop just for a moment, because that is a brave play right there.
Wow. Okay, then. He does have the second Ice Blunk and a barrier in his hand.
I want to point out, we saw this yesterday, though. This was another thing we saw yesterday, where Thor Saint came down, and we're like, I don't know, he's kind of in a dicey spot, but the player we were watching at the time was able to utilize the discounted spells and minions to stabilize the board.
Okay, I'm actually really confused by the tap. I thought the Power of Whelming Doomguard was just looking like it's pretty nuts. But he did decide to go for the tap. This probably means that he can't both clear the Emperor
right.
And pop the Ice Block. Because with the PO Doomguard, I think he could have just done both of the things.
Yeah, just PO the Abusive Sergeant into the Emperor Doomguard face.
Right.
Yeah.
That would have done it.
Interesting.
Let's see what's the plan here.
Yeah, I imagine the egg's going to come down. Definitely coming down, get that juggle. See if you can possibly pick off the Thorsen with the Abusive Sergeant and the Knife Juggle.
Sure.
And at that point, though, you're not going to be able to pop the block. And really, as the zoo player, I'd imagine you want to be popping this block just as soon as humanly possible.
If the juggle from the Nerubian egg hits the Emperor. No, but he doesn't have the mana for the PO anyway.
Oh, wow. Both knives from the jugglers go face, which means I guess he's leaving that Emperor up for another turn. Chooses to pop the block instead. Knife Juggler directed the traffic there. He went, we're going face this turn. These are where the knives go. These are where your minions go. Let's just get rid of that ice block.
That's going to be interesting to see if this works out. It seems like a bit of a gamble to me.
Well, as Saddle said, the Knife Juggler really just decided where those knives were going. And we saw it went right down to the end of that turn. And once Tars kind of saw what was happening, he's like, all right, we're going.
Okay, so the interesting thing here is by doing it the way that he's done it, he has popped the Ice Block and he's left himself with pure burst damage in hand. So he can deal damage now with Doomguard from a frozen board, from an empty board, whatever. He has the opportunity to pop the second block or achieve lethal depending on the situation. The downside of this is that you've left an Emperor Thorasan sitting there for an additional turn. So I see where he was going now with his line. I'm not necessarily sure whether I still agree with it, but there's some merit to it for sure.
Yeah, definitely some merit to it. But Dr. Hippie has pretty good hand to go up against this right now. With the second Ice Block and the Alexstrasza,
right.
Even after the Doomguard, he will still be able to heal up, even though there's no more blocks remaining, obviously.
Tars might not know it, but the window is definitely closing on him with that discounted Alexstrasza in hand. And double Doomsayer, so this is really, really...
Yeah.
This is an interesting play.
This is so cool. This kills the Nerubian, right? If both of those Doomsayers go off, the actual Nerubian from the egg will die in addition, I believe?
I'm actually not sure.
I think so.
I'm not sure if I've seen this before.
I'm going to say no.
This is
going to say no.
No, I don't. Probably not.
All right.
No.
I mean, I hope it happens because I want to know now.
Yeah.
Right. This is definitely a Jeopardino question right here. Amaz, if you're watching, this is the next one for your contest, but I don't think it does. I think what will happen is both Doomsayers will basically proc and then the egg
right.
or the egg will pop after.
Yeah, he is going to get the 4-4. Like 99% sure.
Okay. So what are we doing with the rest of this turn anyway? I mean, are we interacting with those Doomsayers is the question? We don't really. I mean, it's, we can, but it's a hell of a resource, and we'd be relying on some serious jungler RNG. Actually, having already tapped, he can't do it, right?
Yeah, I don't think he can actually do it anyhow.
Yeah, you can see Tara's just kind of like, ugh, this is my turn.
All right, so he can just get it.
All right, cool.
The spider lives.
Yeah.
But here, what a turnaround. Like Dr. Hippie, with the dice barrier and the Alexstrasza is going to be able to heal back up to 23 effectively because of barrier.
Wow, and as we said, you know, Tars took the line where he wanted to hold back that Doomguard so he had burst damage, and his payoff for that was having to leave the Emperor on the board. And you can see leaving Emperor alive for two turns against Freeze Mage, these are some of the things that you can happen. He's just gone from 2 health to 23.
I'm not super sure on this, but I feel like if not for that ice barrier right there, actually, Tars would have had this.
It's
double
true.
Power overwhelming Doomguard with the Nerubian on the board, he would have just had it right there.
Yep.
Absolutely. Yeah, so I guess you can't really like play around Alexstrasza and an ice barrier on the same turn with 8 mana. That's kind of surprising. So I can understand the line that Tars did end up taking.
Tars probably needs to sit down with his knife jugglers after this match and be like, guys, let's focus in here. Yes, face is a place, but that Thorazan really kind of actually took the game from us.
Yeah, but the game is still not over. Dr. Hippie only looking at the Fireball and the Blizzard right now, and Tars does have quite a few minions.
He does. It looks like he's going to have to address this 8-8, though. Leaving that thing around just gives the Freeze Mage way too many options for just lethal on the swing back in a couple of turns. So one power overwhelming invested, which limits his burst damage a little bit and means that he's now going to have to focus on redeveloping a board so that he can deal with this 23 health.
Wow, that's a great pickup. That's exactly what Dr. Hippie needed in this situation. More cards, and even an two Acolytes.
Yeah, I mean, he's been lacking his card draw for a large period of this game. I think that's where it really went wrong in the mid game. We talked about how great the Double Scientist opening was,
right,
but he didn't hit that mid game card draw to keep him going, and now it's all just coming out at once for him.
So, fatigue plan? We're on the fatigue plan. Right, there we go. Two Acolytes out, we're just going to put one damage into that one, two damage into this one, and we're just going to fatigue this mage out. He doesn't have Alexstrasza anymore.
Sure, Rob. Let's go down that line.
Great
see
moments.
Where it gets us.
Great moments in ladder history.
Yeah.
When you just decide you're gonna fatigue out the Freeze Mage Azu. Obviously, not a great play against the Freeze Mage Azu, but.
Yeah, I don't think that would actually work out in this situation because there's still those two fireballs.
Probably not. I would assume there's more heal bots in here, and yeah, the fireballs, right, and the blizzards, and all the other things that basically work super well against Azu.
Thor's not going to tap first. I guess he's planning to play the Doom card in that case.
Yeah, that's what it looks like. He definitely has the tap option to try and pick up a decent Battlecry here to work with that brand. Something like Defender of Argus would be fantastic. But I think he needs to find some way of addressing those Acolytes of Pain, because really you're holding on to the fact as the Zoo player here that the Freeze Mage has no cards. So if I can just keep drawing two cards a turn, I'm in good shape. It looks like he disagrees. He's just going ham. He's going ham.
He's had enough of all this card draw business.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, Dr. Hippie with two cards in his hand, we haven't seen much AoE, and with those extra draws from the Acolyte, he would get minimum of two extra cards anyway, so I think this is the play to win, so to say.
Actually, the more I think about it, the more I like it, because he's now seen both blocks, both barriers, so there may or may not be a healbot in this deck. There most commonly is these days, but he can possibly look at that 11 life now and say, well, that's your life total for the rest of the game. My job is to get rid of that. I believe he still has second Doomguard in his deck.
Right, it's been there.
So the aggressive play definitely makes a lot of sense here, actually.
Now comes the Blizzard. That's going to stall out the board a little bit. We actually see a fair bit of burst in Dr. Hippie's hand now between the Roaring Torch and the Fireball. So he's actually just getting close to piecing it together. And there's the Frost Nova, and the ice chaining begins.
Yeah, with the two extra mana. Oh, sorry, four mana. He can also ping his own Acolyte here to get even more cards.
Second Frostnova. Wow, they come in pairs. You got the two Doomsayers back to back, and then you got the two Frostnovas.
Thors picks up the fourth abusive.
Wow,
that is so important. I am Beak Owl into Abusive Sergeant. I was just about to reiterate the point of Battlecry minions and Frozen minions, and now he's just in range of Doomguard.
Yeah, the last Doomguard would seal the deal. Is there a way for Dr. Hippie to fill the board from Tars' side? I don't think so. He can spawn one extra imp, but he can't spawn two, because that would actually be pretty nice with the Frost Novas.
That would actually be a really high-level play if he made that happen, but as you said, it's not quite possible here, so that Doomguard draw is a very real prospect right now.
Yeah, it looks like Dr. Hippie maybe was trying to pick up his heal, but in this situation, going for those draws. He has quite a bit of damage now. Two fireballs and a Roaring Torch, so that's going to be enough. But there's going to be one turn for Tarvs now to pick up that second Doomguard for the win.
More importantly, he can also tap still. He still has the opportunity to tap, so he's getting two draws, really.
Yeah, and if he plays a second Iron Peak Owl, that would also do it.
One time, Doomguard off the top, one time.
That's a whiff. What's it going to be? Loatheb is not going to be enough. The 9-mana Fireball will still seal the game here for Dr. Hippie.
Yeah, Tarz is going to just mull it over, try to figure out if there's anything he could possibly do. He still might just end up dropping the Loatheb. See what happens just for putting it down.
Probably just hoping that there's no Frostbolt or Fireball in the Dr. Hippie's hand, but we know better. Dr. Hippie is going to tie this one up.
Yeah, this was really well navigated by Tarz, actually. This is a matchup that really goes against the Zoo player, generally speaking, so I really like the way he played this, and I'm really impressed by people including Iron Beak Owl in their deck. Again, I said this yesterday, when you're playing on ladder and you're just trying to grind it out to try to get stars and basically get up the rankings, you're not necessarily thinking, all right, I need to have that Owl for that fringe situation. You're thinking more raw power, more pressing my agenda. But once you get into these tournaments, you really start have to start thinking about these things.
Absolutely. Owl a little bit more common in Zoo, but we saw it being teched into things like Secret Paladin previously, which it's more of a flex slot card. Right. As you said, if you're coming into a meta where you expect things like Freeze Mage, suddenly Iron Beak Owl becomes a really, really strong tech card.
Absolutely. It's one of the best cards to fight against Freeze Mage, because that Doomsayer Nova turnaround can just end the game right there if there's not enough Nerubian X or similar type of Death Rattle cards.
Right, so we now enter best of three here. So anything can happen, obviously, but I really like what we've seen so far from both players. They both played this really well, and again, reiterating what I said earlier, both of these players absolutely deserve to be here. Might not necessarily have heard of them at home, but they're coming in here, they're doing work, and yeah, nothing but nice things to say about these guys.
Right, I think that game we just watched was a really high-level game. There was a few moments where Savitz and I were discussing some different lines, but when we sort of thought about it, you know, their lines made sense. You know, this is a thing with Hearthstone, there isn't necessarily one optimal line. There are different players will disagree, and they'll fight their own corner and say, no, this is better, this is the way to do it. But the important thing is, like, once you pick your line, be consistent with it and follow it through to its conclusion.
Right, and the Juggles could have also worked out way better for him in the situation where he chose to leave up the Emperor, which ended up being his downfall. But it could have just, he could have gotten a little bit more lucky there to take it out.
Well, the jugglers could have been a little more skilled, is what I would say. Those jugglers, it was a combination of luck on someone's part and just poor performance by the jugglers. But yeah, that was really the swing turn that kind of decided everything. So we're going to hop right in now to, wow, so we didn't actually see the Ancient of War from Dr. Hippie the first time, but That's a big card against Zoo.
That's a huge card against Zoo. Again, we did see Iron Beak Owl, which can be a reasonably strong answer to it if it comes down, but otherwise it's still a 5-5. And hello, that is pretty much the nuts against Zoo.
We have a game right here. Like, both players with excellent starting hands. That Void Walker is also really, really good to fight against those saplings.
The only thing that would make this more perfect is if Tarz drew a Knife Juggler and played it next turn, and then Dr. Hippie just curved into Keeper of the Grove and they connected. As always happens every single ladder game I play as a druid, I just always have that Keeper of the Grove and the Knife Juggler rolls up. I'm like, nope, you juggle nothing.
Yeah, as Savitz pointed out though, this game could have very, very easily been a blowout if it wasn't for that Void Walker from Tarz here, because it prevents that Living Roots from getting value on the board. If that Living Roots was able to just trade for Tarz's one drop, that Keeper coming down after the Wild Growth would have just been such a huge advantage.
Certainly, because now Tarz is going to play another minion that is going to be a good target for the Keeper, but the Keeper can't take out both, so Tarz likely to play the Direwolf Alpha here, but then Dr. Hippie has to make a decision whether he wants to kill the Flaming Boar or the Wolf.
So is there any merit in playing the Dark Peddler over the Direwolf?
There is. It gives you more options for next turn, but next turn you just have the 3 mana anyway to play Peddler and whatever one drop you might pick, and you also have the opportunity to just play Peddler, pick a card for a future turn, and play Flame Imp. So I like Savitz's line here of just being aggressive, dropping the Wolf, getting in there, and putting the pressure on the Druid to have the answers.
Yeah, I don't think there's any real reason to not play the Direwolf over the Peddler here, because he wouldn't be able to play the card like Solo mentioned, so right. Makes more sense this way around.
Right, Dr. Hippie is now on turn 4, essentially, for Druid time. And he's got a, what is it? We have like a clock. It's like New York time, Los Angeles time, Druid time. It's just like always turn four. All right, so we see he's got the Keeper of the Grove. He's kind of highlighting here. He's not sure. Yep. Oh, no, never mind. He's very sure what he wants to get rid of. So that goes away, and yeah, doesn't even bother attacking into the Voidwalker there.
No, but here's the Peddler. Easy one. Let's see what he picks up.
I mean, nothing great in terms of tempo cards. Usually those are the cards that you're looking to pick up as Zoo, your Abusive Sergeants, your Power Overwhelmings, etc. But Argent Squire is a nice, resilient minion, but I'd be surprised to see him go with the Flame Imp this turn instead, just for the more aggressive board presence.
Yeah, Argent Squire, exactly what he was hoping to get, but it's not the worst thing either, because it is resilient, and with Power Overwhelming, it can help clear some big tones.
Yeah, like Tar's really deciding what he wants to do, whether or not he wants to trade into that 1-1, or if he just wants to go face. And I'm sure he's also considering what his opponent is going to be doing on the next turn, which turn 5, naturally Druid of the Claw turn. We see Dr. Hippie doesn't actually have that, but he does have something pretty good.
That's not bad at all. The swipe was a little bit awkward, because you haven't seen an implosion yet, and you rather use the swipe after the implosion has been played from the Aggro Warlock, so I'd expect to see the Keeper here. I must
safeguard them. Yeah, it's definitely one of the things that strong Zoo players will look out for in this matchup. They'll try and get enough pressure down to force a swipe and then follow that up with the implosion afterwards.
Exactly. That's a great strategy, and a lot of experienced players are going for that. Here, with the Defender of Argus, that might be a little bit better than the implosion would be. Allows him to take out both of the Keepers if he wants to.
Right, and this sets up the situation where suddenly there's a really nice swipe on the board. So we may see that exact interaction we just discussed, where the swipe comes down and then the implosion is used as a follow-up.
Right, this is the point where Tar's like, come on, swipe my board. Yeah. Look at this, two minions with one health. You can't, this is great, premium swipes here. And he gets his wish, board gets swiped, and pure power comes out, and that happy little tree has been alive since turn one.
Damn you, Rob.
No, I didn't even mean to do it that time. It's a subconscious thing now. I'm telling you, I can't fight the Rob Boss instincts. Wow, implosion on a 1-1.
Yep. Oh, only rolls for two, but suddenly that Argent Squire just being like a standalone minion actually isn't bad for him here, because he's able to fill out his curve.
Yep.
Not bad, but certainly not as good as Dr. Boom.
Not many things are, Rob. Not many things are.
Yeah, he's pretty strong. He also brought some boys with him.
Yeah.
He's like, oh, you play three minions. I'll also play three minions.
Oh, he has quite a decent play here, I suppose. With the Power Overwhelming Doom card, he would have 7 damage from those minions that he already has on the board, so that for 5-7, he's only going to discard one card and gets a decent amount of damage on face.
Yeah, it's a pretty potentially high-value card that he's discarding, but you can't be looking at that. You can't be greedy with your cards when you need to make the tempo play in a very, very tempo-focused matchup.
Yeah, I completely agree. If he went for a tap there, he could play the 2-4, but the 5-7 with the charge, it's just so much more impactful.
I actually feel like Brand Bronzebeard is probably the card I see most discarded off of Doom Guards these days. Like, it is a really powerful card. Absolutely can be used with things like Abusive Sergeant, Defender of Argus, but it's one of those things where when it's sitting in your hand and you're looking at that Doom Guard, you're like, how much do I need Brand Bronzebeard?
The Doom Guard just wants to take revenge on Brand for making him discard four cards every time it's done the other way around.
Curse of Reflux! That is a card.
That certainly is a card.
Wow, and
but
what a poor follow-up.
It is not exactly the card that he would like to have right now, though.
All right. High IQ Hearthstone players on the desk. That's you two.
Uh-huh.
Why do you run Curse of Reflux?
The Freeze Mage, but he never drew it.
Right.
Against the Freeze Mage. That would have done the job against the Ice Blocks.
Yeah,
but he just didn't got it.
It's a strong tech card against classes that need to ration out their mana extremely hard. Also, classes that can potentially have upwards of 8 cards in their hand. You can actually use it to mill them. Definitely not a card that he's teched in with the Druid matchup in mind, I don't think.
Like, right now here, it looks a little bit silly. But if he drew it in the previous match, but I looked. It's so genius.
I would like it better if he did the innervate first and then the Curse of Reflux. Like, I really got to get this out of my hand. That is a pretty bad spot for Tars to be in. Honda Creeper, not what you want to see. And maybe just hit the old tap button, see if maybe 6 mana Deathwing comes out, but.
Yeah, this is a very sad feeling as Zoo. It can happen where sometimes you just draw 3 or 4, small early game cards in a row on later turns, and you just don't have the pressure against bigger mid-range and control decks. And that's what's happened to Tars here, and he's just going to have to have given away the game because of it.
he's still, I like that he played it out, though, and kind of sat and made him actually have the answer because, you know, again, the winner of this goes to the Europe Winter Championship, so a lot on the line, a huge jump in terms of prize pool, so Tars played it out. Ultimately, Dr. Hippie is now going to go up 2-1. The Druid is done, but man, that Curse of Rafam, that is... Talk about deck builders who include a twist. Like, that's a crazy card that we have... I don't think we've seen that in any tournaments thus far.
Yeah, I mean, I guess that's why he didn't ban the Freeze Mage, because he had it countered, but he just never drew it. And now against the Druid, well, just a little bit late. One game too late.
Yeah, we were discussing it earlier about how sometimes because of the nature of Conquest, you don't necessarily get the matchup you want. So as you guys said, he wanted this against Freeze Mage probably. Druid a little more mana flexible, especially once it gets those later turns. And maybe Curse of Rafam is something you actually want really early on against a Freeze Mage. When would you even use it?
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of times you can use it, but a lot of Freeze Mage's turns are very mana locked. You know, they have to spend 6 mana casting Blizzard on turn 6. They don't have that flexible slot open to spend the extra 2 mana. So you really do make them make the choice of, oh, am I just going to sit here taking damage from this card every turn, or can I afford to throw it away and take the tempo of what's being thrown back against me?
All right, maybe put in that Thorasand first, reduce the cost of your curse.
Oh, damn!
The old one mana cursed. obviously not a very common play at all, because again, we just never see this card. So I like that Tars is bringing new things, and I don't know, I'd be curious to see the rest of those deck lists now and see if there's any other just really janky kind of cards in there. But yeah, it looks like game 4 here about to begin. Dr. Hippie needs one more win, and he has Doomhammer in the opening hand playing his Aggro Shaman. So if you haven't had a chance to see this deck much, well, you're probably better off for it, because it's one of those decks that just beats you into the ground pretty heavily. But Doomhammer is kind of where it all lines up.
Yeah, it certainly is one of those cards that you just have to have against classes with healing especially. And choosing to not keep the Rockbiter here, it's definitely something to consider when going second, because you can, the Rockbiter does allow you to deal with something like a Flaming from your opponent.
Sure, but I think you wanted to just go for a decent curve of early minions, just be competitive on the board that way against Zoo, and that's definitely what he has.
Yeah.
Generally, Zoo tends to struggle against outright face aggro decks as opposed to board aggro decks. Shaman, not quite as effective at crushing Zoo as Hunter is. They don't have access to things like Explosive Trap.
Looks like replacing the Rockbiter worked out really well. He picked up a lot of solid minions there. Even that Sir Finley, even though it's only a 1-3, it matches up excellently against the abusive Surgeon from Tars' side.
And he picks up the Druid hero power, which generally the Hunter hero power is the optimal one for this deck in almost every situation. But with Doomhammer in hand, once you equip Doomhammer, Druid hero power, Hunter hero power, essentially the same thing.
Yep.
You're going to see some crazy burst damage come once the Doomhammer is equipped. Shapeshift starts being used there, just huge hammer swings and ugh. I enjoy it so much. There's something super satisfying about equipping the Doomhammer and just like, all right, let's play. Just start bashing him in the face over and over. It's kind of just, I mean, how much better does it get? Giant hammer, 2 swings a turn.
I don't think it gets any better.
No, that is the most fun you will ever have in Hearthstone, short of playing Curse of Rafam.
Short of playing Curse of Rafam,
well,
indeed.
I don't think he was having much fun playing it the last game, though.
Well, maybe not in the situation, but I think he probably felt really cool when he played. He's like, I'm on stream, check out my Curse of Rafam.
Yep. So this is a pretty solid turn for him here, Earthshock, Abusive Sergeant. But he's just going to have to pay a little bit of attention with how he manages his overload over the next couple of turns, because making sure he has the mana available for that Doomhammer to come down on turn 5 is just going to be so huge.
He could even just turn 4, bring it out.
That's very true, yeah.
He's not overloaded for anything at all, so that Doomhammer just comes out next turn, and I expect to see a big frown on the face of Tars.
That implosion was absolutely a great draw. Does roll low on it, but even a roll of 2 was enough to take out the Totem Golem.
Oh. Well, now we have a decision to make.
We do have an important decision to make, and it's to hit the coin and then hit Doomhammer. That's the decision, Sonal.
Oh, but come on, the greed. Get that Tunnel Trog down. Buff it with Doomhammer. No. Okay.
Trogs don't rule. Okay. Doomhammer rules. Here's the thing, though. If you put that down, then you're probably going to want to play something like Ancestral Knowledge with it as well. I would assume to get value, right?
So the play I would look at here is Tunnel Trog, Loot Hoarder, Coin Hero Power, and take out one of the 1/1s. And then it's unlikely that you lose your board. You know, you have a decent board position next turn. You can just continue to play the Doomhammer on curve. And you have potential, if there's no buffs in hand, that the Doomhammer comes down and does even more damage because of the additional buff.
Yeah, I also like this much better than the Doomhammer, because the Warlock player is still at full health, so...
And Saddle's making inappropriate gestures at me, basically solidifying his win now that they have agreed with that Doomhammer was not the correct. I don't care. Doomhammer was just the correct course of action, but yeah. Jokes aside, big board set up. You have a Trog that's just ready to get buffed up and begin wailing on people, and Dr. Hippie is in a really good spot. And the worst part is Tars doesn't actually know how good of a spot Dr. Hippie is in.
Right. It's always the dread, and maybe Tars is sat there right now thinking, was Coin Doomhammer better than that line of play that he took right there? Does this mean he doesn't have Doomhammer in hand?
Tars knows. If you had the Coin Doomhammer, you're going to play it.
So from his perspective, he's going to be thinking about first how he addresses that Tunnel Troll, because it's a hugely terrifying minion in the deck. And secondly, he's definitely considering whether or not Doomhammer is going to come down, because no matter which matchup you're playing, that's the card you're scared of from this deck.
Yeah, it's true. The Doomhammer is what gives the additional damage that really you need to be able to end the game, because the early minion pressure was not quite there. Dr. Hippie didn't manage to get the damage in with his first minion, so Doomhammer is going to play a big role in this potential win.
Silences the Loot Hoarder, wow.
Well, you saw he wasn't sure. He was kind of right. Gravitating back and forth. He's like, these are two things I would both like to have silence. And
here we go.
Tars is like, nah, there's the Doomhammer.
Yep.
Double trade? I like double trade here. Yep's going to go for it. Just go bank himself all in on that Tunnel Trog now. He has the Doomhammer damage to back it up. Ancestral Knowledge, Lava Shock next turn is a fantastic combination to follow this up. And looks like Tars is going to go digging here for double options. Soulfire, pretty great, actually.
Yeah, that's a pretty solid card. And because of Brand Bronzebeard, he's actually going to get to discover two cards.
Mm-hmm.
But see here, neither of these are
not
attractive.
But with the Soulfire, maybe the bad one drop from here will be the one that gets discarded.
Right. Let's see. He does in fact lose the Undertaker.
Undertaker briefly makes an appearance and then is summarily ejected from the. Oh goody.
Rob and I just had a little fight over who was going to make exactly the same joke there, and Rob just jumps in.
Saddle, you're the smart one here. You say smart things. I say the cringy things.
All right.
Thank
cool.
you.
So Ancestral Knowledge is cast here. He does have the Lava Shock to unlock if he would like to. I believe it would unlock now 4 total mana crystals. Is that right?
Two extra for this turn and two for the following next turn. Yeah.
So he would give himself 4 mana to play with this turn, and he has ways of spending 4 mana.
It's an interesting decision here, because there's no perfect way to deal with that Brand Bronzebeard right now, and it's kind of scary to leave up in case of a Defender of Argus or other Battlecry minions.
So he is going to go ahead and use the Lava Shock, which gives him an additional 2 mana to use, and it's a matter of, okay, looks like he's just going to be intimidated by the Brand Bronzebeard, which many, many players are, and you can't really blame them. It can make so many explosive things happen, and he's just building up a ton of burst damage resource in his hand.
Right. And I like that, because that Defender of Argus is exactly why, especially when so much of your game plan at this point is predicated on using that hammer. Defender of Argus would have just been brutal.
Oh, this is going to be a huge juggle right here. Can he kill the Loot Hoarder?
Gets it.
Good job. Good knife juggler.
Like, oh!
Wow, that's quite a bit of damage, I would say.
So in total, we have 10, 15, 18, 20 plus...
One minimum?
Plus Mystery Crackle, yeah, so... that's a lot of damage.
But yeah, he can hold on to one of his spells. With the hero power here, he won't be able to cast all of those cards in his hand right now, but look, the Crackle should be enough for next turn after the Lava Burst and the Lightning Bolt this time.
Yeah, and this is absolutely correct ordering here. He's banking all his melee damage in the form of the Rockbiter first to play around Defender of Argus. He's played some very long games against this deck and actually hasn't seen Loetheb come out yet, if I'm correct. So
that's not a draw you want to see.
Oh, the BM Flame Imp. I got so tilted by these cards when it was a very heavy Face Hunter meta that I actually cut them from my deck at some point. Just because of this exact situation. You just always draw it when you're about to die.
Oh no, Tars has no idea how dangerous that Daft was. And now even with the low Crackle, that is going to be lethal for Dr. Hippie. And he's going to be our first top 8 player for the LAN Finals next month.
Right, very... very well-mannered by Tars, given the well-played. It wasn't at all ironic. It was a great series he played with Dr. Hippie. And Dr. Hippie, as you said, going to be one of those first top 8 players, going to the Europe Winter Championship, fighting for that prize pool of $100,000, and the opportunity to travel to the Hearthstone World Championship.
Absolutely. And I think we just watched a great series between two very, very strong players. I was definitely impressed with some of the lines of play I saw, some of the decision-making, and very at least excited, if maybe not impressed, by some of the deck choices, with Curse of Reform making its way into Zoo.
Yeah, I really like what Tars brought. I thought he did a great job playing those series. And imagine how different this series would have been if the Curse of Rafam had come out against that Freeze Mage.
Right. Yeah, it would have been huge. But yeah, like it was said, that the series was excellent. Seeing these new players come up, they really showed how they got this far. They've been playing good all the way and well-deserved. And also here, Tars is not out yet. He's in the lower bracket and still has a chance to qualify to top 8.
Yeah, and just to give a little bit of background on Tars, obviously he's now one of the players that we have in the top 8. So we gave Dr. Hippie a little bit of an intro. We kind of glossed over Tars. He's in fact won DreamHack France in the past, which is obviously a huge tournament. So he's no stranger to the competitive scene, and he's made another big splash here, getting himself into top 8.
Yeah, I would love to see him, more of him in tournament, more of these kind of, you know, silly, crazy decks. Well, not even silly, you know, that's overstating it. Curse of Rafam seems silly to us, maybe because we haven't necessarily played the matchups he has, and we haven't had his ladder or tournament experience, but, you know, he obviously had a plan for that Curse of Rafam, and I would love to see more of these kind of cards he puts in there to differentiate himself from other players.
Definitely one of the things that makes Hearthstone tournaments interesting is the variation, people's different ideas, not only on which tech cards to play, which lineups to bring, and even just ways of playing individual matchups that a lot of people just disagree on.
Yeah, there's a lot of small decision making and a lot of like cool deck building. We also saw this double Forgotten Torches from Dr. Hippie, not something you always see, the Novice Engineer. It's really cool to me to see that this newer and more unique deck list can also work well.
All right, we're going to go ahead and send it over to Frodan in the host area to get his thoughts on the matchup.
Thank you very much, Rob and crew. That's right. We have one of our players who's going to the Winter Championships, but it's not a person that you've come to expect, Dr. Hippie, with his unusual deck choices. Well, unusual card choices, maybe a little bit of twists on normal conventions. We don't have an interview with Dr. Hippie, unfortunately, but what we can do is to talk a little bit about the other brackets and how they're shaping up. The one match that everyone was paying attention to was Sho versus Gaara in the lower bracket. And I'm happy to report for Liquid fans and probably Savitz as well that Sho has taken that series 3-1, sending Gaara home and moving on the bracket. 6-0 has also continued to stay alive in losers round 6, defeating Lutur Dombr. I'm really bad about that, sorry. 3-0. And being able to sweep with a very effective strategy. Also, a couple of players have been able to go through. We saw Sway yesterday trying to go through. He's defeated Kalspera, and Gamebreaker has beaten Squip. It's a lot of updates going on, so make sure if you want to follow along with us, go ahead and type !! in the chat. You can get the link to Battlefy, and then you'll be able to follow along with us throughout the process. In the meantime, guys, we also want to once again encourage you guys to stay engaged in the conversation. If you hashtag HCT, you might be able to have some of your tweets featured on stream. You can do so by tweeting us at Play Hearthstone as well, and show us some of your favorite things going on in the broadcast. And if you're on Facebook, go to facebook.com/Hearthstone. Don't go anywhere, guys. We're going to have yet another awesome match here at the Winter Prelims, so stay tuned. We'll be right back. We'll be right back.